Hello again, and welcome back to another edition of The Wiccan Conservative. After all the impeachment hearings and everything that has come and gone this past week, we're here to talk about some other things that have come and gone over the weekend. Usually I like to look into the stories that I bring to you guys. If it's not a live matter, something that's happening immediately or going on. I had two stories that kind of came up over the weekend and garnered a little bit of action, if you will, on the news circuit. And then all of a sudden, they kind of died down and disappeared. So the first story that we're going to talk about is Whiskey Warrior and what really happened in regards to this veteran with a record of PTSD and, you know, his past charges and whatnot. If you folks heard about this, there was a gentleman in New York who was involved in an 8-hour standoff with police. It ended peacefully at the end of the 8 hours, but he was kind of live streaming from the attic, I believe, of his home, and really kind of set off a chain of events, at least in my news feed, when it came to the gun owners and the regular media and how they were portraying this event. The first thing I wanted to kind of touch upon is when I went back and watched his Instagram feed, it seemed like the gentleman was very distressed from the point of view that he was in, and almost like he had a drink or was drunk or was kind of, you know, just not quite there. The media obviously used that to spin their narrative that it was a domestic dispute. His wife had supposedly called on him and, you know, they were going to collect him for breaking and entering and threatening the wife and the child. And supposedly he threatened to kidnap the kid. And it was a big mess. But if you go into his posts and his feed from the actual event as it was happening, he was spinning a very different story. He had said that, you know, he didn't even have a weapon in the home, and there were claims of a weapon being in the home. He claimed that one of his fellow veterans had called the police on him and stated that he was PTSD and that he was not mentally stable and that there was you know, a chance that he was going to get into a shootout with the police if they tried to confront him. And this is kind of how this all started. But when you go to the text messages that he was having with people through his Instagram account, he stated a very different story that after the claim was made from his veteran friend that they had showed up on his doorstep while he was at work and threatened his wife with CPS, that they were going to actually come in and take her children away if she didn't disclose his location. And this led to him coming home from work, and you know, during the event, we don't know where the wife was. I couldn't seem to find anyone that told me where the wife was during the events, just stating that she was safe and was away from the situation. They had interviews with his neighbors. They had people kind of at a distance from his location. And, you know, it raised a lot of questions. It's kind of like we were watching in real time the news again, coming up with a completely different narrative as opposed to what the person who was actually going through the events was stating was happening. And of course, you know, what we've seen with the impeachment hearings, and depending upon what network you watch them on, it was the same testimony with two different narratives. So it was really interesting to me before I wanted to even, you know, comment or get involved, because obviously if this is a red flag law in play, this was something that I had brought up to Dan Crenshaw on his Facebook, his Twitter, and you know, different social media accounts, is, you know, when the red flag laws go into effect, how does that affect our military personnel when they come home? So, you know, in essence, we send these young boys and women off to war, and then they come home with these issues. And, you know, a lot of them come home with PTSD. And that seemed to be the catalyst or the turning factor for anybody that was labeled mentally ill or having a problem, or that being the initiative to a red flag confiscation. So, you know, are these soldiers coming home with these issues? We're telling them that they're good enough to have a gun on foreign soil, but they're not good enough to have a gun to protect their family here in the States. You know, it was something that really kind of concerned me with Dan wanting to bolster the red flag laws and state that, you know, it was just to protect the American people or whatever. But I digress. We need to figure out exactly what happened in Whiskey Warrior's situation. So I tried to do a little bit of digging, and I tried to look into these past charges. The media claimed that he had passed charges on him, and that this wasn't his first encounter with the police. And, you know, I went to the local county websites for the New York district that he resides in, and I did happen to pull up a young man who seemed to fit the age and, of course, the name description, but I couldn't pull the exact records, and I couldn't find out exactly what the charges were or exactly if it matched Whiskey Warrior's profile. So it was a little bit odd to me. And it was funny because it was only one particular website that had this information on it. And if you've ever done a Google search on yourself, you'll find out, like, there's a lot of people that share your name, and they're not necessarily you. It's not somebody that carries the same social security number as you. And, you know, actually me, myself, I've noticed that, you know, even with my credit report, I've been on to the credit report, and there's actually a young lady who has the exact same maiden name as I have, down in Alabama. And I had to work for like 7 years to differentiate between her credit and my credit, because she was racking up Verizon bills and all different kinds of crazy things. So, you know, these things are out there where, they're attaching negative information to people's namesakes that isn't really necessarily that person. And it's not they're doing. So I was a little bit confused with, you know, only one website having a background information for him, and also not being able to find very much about the story. A lot of what was posted from a lot of Second Amendment pages that I follow, people who jumped right on what Whiskey Warrior said the initial cause of contact was, and that was a red flag law confiscation gone wrong. But if you go through the entire story, he wasn't picked up for any charges in relation to the standoff. So at the end of the day, he didn't get hit with any type of gun violation laws. He didn't get hit with any type of evading or eluding arrest or anything like that. So it kind of makes me wonder if he had not been streaming the way that he had been streaming, or getting the information out there the way that he was getting the information out there, would the charges have been different? Would they have went about it a different way? We'll never know, because he took the initiative to make sure that he live streamed and got his point of view out to the public. So the other thing that really kind of struck me is after the incident, it was the eve of my birthday, I believe, that it had happened. So it was November 24th. And then by the 25th, there was little patches of people who were still talking about it. And then by today, I have not seen a shadow of anything having to do with it from the mainstream media or from the Second Amendment gun sites. So I'm not completely convinced either way. I would still like to get to the bottom of it, and it doesn't seem like we're going to hear the end of that story. The media does a really good job of bringing certain things to you, and some of your pages will do that to you as well. They'll bring certain news to you and ask you to feel or act in a certain way, and then you'll never hear the end of the story. So you never get from point A to point B in a nice, clean road. You have to figure it out yourself. So it's just, it's a little something that reminds you that, you know, there's three sides to every story. There's your side, there's their side, and then there's the truth. So for anybody that was watching this story or has any information about this story, I'd love to get a link or some type of background information about this gentleman, or even some follow-up information if you know anything that's going on now after the fact. The second story that I wanted to kind of bring back into the equation is the Jeffrey Epstein story. After he had committed suicide in his jail cell, it kind of disappeared for a very long time. And depending again on who you follow and what type of news sites and sources you get your information from, everything just kind of fell below the wayside, and oh yay, another pedophile is dead. We really had to pretty much force somebody, I think, to take action. I think the fact that there was a small group of people who refused to let it go. As you guys all know, I think Steven Crowder actually did a live stream about Jeffrey Epstein didn't kill himself and kind of tried to debunk the whole manner of death. And a little bit prior to that, we found out that the guards that were on duty during his night of demise were arrested. And it's not like they were arrested for anything kind of crazy, really speaking, or for not doing their job. They were arrested for falsifying records and manipulating the jail logs and how long that they were looking into what they were supposed to be doing. Because if you remember, excuse me, he was on suicide watch the week before. I think he was on suicide watch for approximately 10 days. And then they said he was okay to go into kind of just a solitary type deal where he was supposedly in a cell by himself. And they were supposed to be monitoring his movements, and it was supposed to be documented. And as the story goes, the guards just fell asleep or weren't doing their job. And when you come across the fact that they were arrested, they claimed that they were buying gifts or something on Amazon. They were online shopping, I think, was the final conclusion as to what was going on with the guards at the time of his death. And the one guard came out and said, you know, it wasn't the other one's fault. I'm going to go ahead and take the blame for the both of us. So, yeah, we both should have been doing our jobs and our logs, and we weren't. But as far as, you know, a major blame is put, I want to take that blame, and it wasn't this person's fault. And to me, that's kind of fishy, to say the least, is if you know that you're not doing your job and the both of you are supposed to be creating these logs. I think they had every 2 hours they were supposed to be in there checking up. And then you think about all the background information behind what happened with Epstein about the camera malfunctions. And then these people are online shopping, and, you know, all the just right pieces that had to fall into place in order for him to pull off this suicide it's just really strange to me. And my first thought was, well, they found a scapegoat. Finally, you know, they're going to try to trot these two guards out there, and there's going to be some sort of acquittal, or there's going to be some sort of deal made with these two guards who were in charge of this records and, you know, taking care of watching this man. But apparently, it seems to me that it's going to get buried along with all different kinds of things that are going on, with the impeachment kind of taking center stage and the Democrats trying so hard to bolster this, act in front of the American people, because we all know that there's absolutely nowhere for them to proceed without any solid information. The he said, she said is getting really old. And you use that into the Jeffrey Epstein case where, you've got this guard now saying, well, it was my fault. And then what happens if the other one comes out and says, well, no, it was my fault. So now you've got two different people who are acting against each other, in order to kind of cover up their own butts. But my first instinct would be, go into their bank accounts and see, if there's any type of change or influx or differentiating money, and get to the bottom of it, follow the money, because there's got to be a reason why these two are being trotted out in the American public's eye as scapegoats. Yeah, they were the ones on duty. And yeah, ultimately, they did falsify the records. They come right out and said they had no problem saying that they falsified these documents, and they had no problem telling the world that they were the ones on duty. So at that point in time, you've got to ask yourself, well, why are these people doing this? And how long had they been doing this? Is this something that happened this week? Was this something that only happened with this particular inmate? I would be really interested to dig into the records and find out a little bit more about these two and what type of record they have in the jails. I think the one guard, the male guard, was there for, I want to say 20 years or so. I can't remember exactly. I did go and look up a little bit of information about them. But the female guard, she had only been there for about, 7 years or something like that. It was significantly less than what the male guard had been there. He was a long-standing employee, and she was somebody who just came onto the scene rather recently, which is also something that struck me kind of funny, is, they had a female guard there for a max security prison inmate. And I get it, you're just watching jail cells and whatnot, but it just is one of those things where, again, the numbers just don't add up to me. It just doesn't seem like that's a plausible resource, or that was a plausible answer. And, it's just kind of being presented to us as a fact. And for sure, these are the two that let it happen. And here's your bad guys. So now we can just move on and forget about all the, poor suffering girls that wanted to see actual justice done. It just feels very lackluster to let him kind of live with his own demise and not get to the bottom of what exactly happened in that jail cell that night. Was it actually possible? And why were there the just right conditions that we don't have video footage, and we don't have the right documentation, and we don't have the answers that I think we deserve? When you get somebody that high up and you want to prove that the system works and you want to prove that there's still justice in this country, you can't allow something like this to happen, and you can't allow them to just kind of take matters into their own hands. And I know a lot of criminals do that, and a lot of people end up, committing suicide and, the whole suicide by cop thing and all that jazz. But It'll be interesting to see how this plays out. And again, if you have any information or background information regarding Jeffrey Epstein or the guards, drop me a link and let me know. I'm always looking for new information and things to follow up on. Last but not least, I just wanted to say that the YouTube guidelines are supposedly changing in December. From what I've read, if you are not marketable to YouTube and if you are not creating revenue, or if you don't have X amount of followers, or even some of your content, if it doesn't fall within their exact guidelines, and we know about all the kind of censoring that's going on and all that jazz, you're going to be removed, you're going to be kicked off, and your free speech is going to end. So if you don't see me after December 10th and the new guidelines go into play, I can just leave you with go out and always seek the truth. And I hope that I don't get cut. I guess the good way to do that would be to share the videos and follow and try to add to my subscribers. I know I'll never make, I think they want like 10,000 viewers or something to that effect. With it being such a short ride for me, I might be getting off this train sooner rather than later. But never stop seeking the truth. Even if they cut me out of this streaming and they cut my voice out of YouTube, I don't think it'll stop anybody from seeking the truth. And I don't think that I will stop here. I will try to continue to go out and make my opinions heard. And even when it dissents against the conservative movement or the liberal movement or whatever, you know, just get out there and make sure that you are not allowing your voice to be silenced and you're not allowing yourself to be brainwashed. So that's all I have for you guys today. And hopefully I'll see you on the next one. Bye.